go. Head On with Bob Kincaid. 3 hours of conversation, cussing, and a discussing with America's only born and bred Southern liberal talk host. Head On with Bob Kincaid is brought to you each night by Coal River Mountain Watch. Coal River Mountain Watch invites you to become part of the solution, part of a sustainable future, part of the uprising against mountaintop removal. Coal River Mountain Watch, CRMW.net. And now, from high in the hills of beautiful West Bicod, Virginia, here's Bob Kincaid on the Head On Radio Network.
Well, howdy. And we are off and running for this final broadcast of the second week of October 2018. This is The Horn. HeadOn.live is where we live. That's where you go if you want to jump into the chat room and be part of the merry, wacky, zany, real-time multimedia extravaganza that is The Horn chat room. I'll be there in a minute. I had the tech folks out from Frontier here earlier today, and it involved a whole bunch of rebooting of everything under the sun. I'll be there in a minute, okay? It's 3 minutes past the hour. I apologize for the late start by about a minute and a half, but that was part of the whole everything had to be rebooted kind of thing. And it was more like the second or third reboot, but you know, who's counting when you're having that much fun, right? Sure. Hi, I'm Bob Kincaid. It's Friday on the Front Porch, and we're going to get that started early this evening. I'm filling in tonight, Monday and Tuesday, for Malloy as they recover from some unpleasantry related to the passage of the storm through the foothills of the North Georgia mountains. And so, with that being the case, I have to shut down at 8 p.m. and start everything back up again, flipped over, turned around, pressed down, and shaken together. And that takes about an hour in between programs. So we will have Friday on the Front Porch up until about 8 p.m. That's about an hour and, probably an hour and 54 minutes or so of what I hope is going to be Jim Dandy good conversation. And you're welcome to join in if you've never participated in Friday on the Front Porch before. Well, just send a contact request on Skype. On Skype, mind you. Not to me, but to Sparky Dunk, Sparkydunc, Sparkydunc. And Sparky, who has moderated the Friday on the Front Porch group for years upon years upon years, will show you the breadcrumb trail and the little path that leads to the old hollow tree that we rent from the Keebler Elves, wherein we keep the extraordinary, ordinary round table around which we gather each and every Friday. So jump right in if you want to. Also, we maintain one regular phone line for people who can't figure out how to use Skype. We call it the Stress Line, named in honor of Bill Mr. Stress Miller, legendary bluesman and raconteur of Cleveland, who left this mortal plane a while back, but is not forgotten, and who is, most fondly remembered. That stress line number is 304-640-2829. Toll free, it's 844-843-4676. Okay? We have thanks to send out at the beginning of the program. We always try to do that. Thanks very kindly to Christopher for being a partial sponsor of Independent Liberal Progressive Broadcasting. Thank you to Angelica in Oregon for the same. Thank you, Angelica. Thank you very kindly to Gary up in New York. Thank you very much indeed for helping to keep all of this going and on the air. Thank you to Mark in Minnesota. Thank you, Mark. And thanks as well to Paul in California. Thank you very much indeed for helping to keep all this going. Our subscribers managed to knock out about a quarter of the average month's programming here, and we rely on listeners on an ad hoc basis to get us through the other three quarters. And I'll tell you, the month of October has been rougher than a cob so far. We come into the program this evening with a significant deficit as we've run in a while. In order to wipe out the week, we need to raise $767 this evening. $767. Now, granted, that's a far cry from the kind of money that gets made, you know, out in the for-profit media, but we're not trying to buy any Gulfstream jets or, you know, maintain any swimming pools through the frozen Appalachian winters or anything like that. We're just trying to provide a radio program and keep the lights on here. So $767 is where we stand. It would have been considerably worse were it not for our buddy David, the angry architect in Australia, who jumped in at the very end of things last night and took us down to what at that point in time was you know what? It's not 767. It's 667, which is just one number away from something, you know, really awesome. But that's because David took it down by a considerable lump there at the end of the program last night. Thank you to our buddy, the angry architect. And we're off and running already. Thank you very kindly to Henry for jumping in. And so that takes us down to $617. $617 to go this evening. So that, well, we can pay the bills that keep this program on the air. If we don't reach our fundraising goal this evening and through most of next week, come Friday, well, it'll probably be the last broadcast for a very long while, because there are bills to pay. All of this comes, by the way, as we approach a birthday. Yeah, it's pretty significant. It's highly significant. 12 days from now, okay, the 24th day of October, which falls on a Wednesday. On the 24th of October, this program will be 15 years old. Can you dig it? On October the 24th, this program will have been on the air for the most part every Monday through Friday for 3 hours a night for 15 years. You know, there's been some absences here and there. I've gotten sick once a couple of times and had to lay out a week or so. I think I was gone for a few weeks when my dad passed away. But this program's been on the air for 15 years as of the 24th day of this month, 12 days away. I'd like to see us maybe start on the next 15. Wow. Yeah, why not? But we have to meet our fundraising goals in order to do that. So there we go. The PayPal button is over at headon.live. There's also a subscription button for Patreon at headon.live. Try to make it as easy as possible. If you'd like to become a subscriber, well, the whole goal is that one of these days we're going to have the equivalent of 400 $10 a month subscribers. And then I don't have to talk about this anymore. And the program will be self-sustaining by the community being self-sustaining. You can do that either at Patreon or at PayPal. Just use the button at headon.live. So like I said, we need to get started early. I'm going to ask Sparky to go ahead and get everything rolling. Wow, they must have done a good job fixing the interweb tubes today, because the latency is way the hell down. That's excellent. One less thing to worry about. Thank you. That's big. That's huge. Thank you very kindly to Charlene in Rhode Island for a $75 challenge. Another challenge rolled in from Darlene in Connecticut. And, you know, Connecticut and Rhode Island are not all that far apart from each other. No, they border each other, don't they? My New England knowledge is kind of sketchy. Yes, they do. So, that being the case, there are three challenges. There's a $75 challenge on the table from Charlene in Rhode Island, a $100 challenge from Darlene in Connecticut. And then, Mike in Cascadia, offers a $25 challenge. This was my Kavanaugh confirmation day last Saturday. I had to get away. North Cascades, flush against the Canadian border. You know what, Mike? I can't imagine a nicer place to be avoiding the filthiness that was the Kavanaugh confirmation than where you were. That, my God, that's exquisite. I got some photographs. I spend so much time sitting here in this little studio that I wind up traveling vicariously. I was in Edinburgh, Scotland earlier this afternoon, and I just flew home, and boy, are my arms tired. No, I travel vicariously through the Horn community. Thank you for the challenge, Mike. So that means, okay, here's how it works out. Charlene says if the $75 challenge is met, then she's going to kick in another $75. Darlene said if her challenge is met, she'll throw in the other $17 that gets us down to a nice, round, cipherable number. So if everything taken together, if all the challenges are met, then we're off and running. Because Charlene said if the $75 challenge gets met, she throws in another $75. And Jack in Shreveport just said, for Charlene's, so the whole 75 gets applied, if I need to tell you that. Well, it is so applied. Thank you, Jack. Thank you very, very kindly. Charlene's challenge has been met. That leaves $125 in challenges on the table. I'm trying to do the math. It's a little sketchy. So we know that we're down. Okay. $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, $478, And now there's smoke coming off of my brain. But thank you very kindly, Jack. Thank you, Charlene. So we've got $125 challenges on the table, which if met, that would amount to $250. And that will get us very clear, very close to a Friday on the Front Porch miracle, a community-made miracle. Thanks, y'all. Thanks very much. Let's see if what kind of headway we're making. All right. Andy the Angry Jew jumping in. And Alma jumping in. That means that, let's see. That means that both Mike and Darlene's challenges are met. I don't think this has ever happened quite so fast. This is astonishing. Thank you, Andy, and thank you very much indeed. to Alma. Thank you very much in New Mexico. Thank you, Andy. And thank you, Charlene, for getting the ball rolling. This is tremendous. So now, that being the case, we are less than $200, less than $300 away from finishing the week. That's astonishingly good news. And if we can keep the ball rolling, we will finish the week. And once I get the conversation going with the Extraordinary Ordinary Roundtable, I don't know, maybe I can lick the end of a pencil or something and not rely on ciphering inside my brain, and we'll get an exact number. Hey, Sparky, how are you? Looks like a beautiful day there in Northern California.
Is this thing working?
That thing's on.
Yeah. Well, first of all, I wanted to tell you about what I did last Sunday.
Yes.
I got to stand out here, out in the beautiful backyard, but it was windier than shit. And I got to watch the CDF Air Force bomb a fire.
Oh, I saw the photo of that.
Yeah, well, I didn't get a big picture of the big plane.
Oh, that wasn't the big plane?
No. I think an S-2 Viking, a little plane. They had two of the S-2s, and then they had a four-engine jet. I don't know what kind of jet it is. And then pretty soon I looked over, and here comes the DC-10 from Sacramento. Decided to paint the hill over there. I don't know if you can see Mount Lassen with this video camera.
Well, I'm looking. There's a bush, and I can see what looks like a mountain to the left of the bush.
Yeah, you see everything backwards from me.
Okay, because the big tree and the fence are to my right. Is it all turned around? Well, okay, there's a tree to my left too. Yeah, we're talking about video on the radio. This is also known as dancing about architecture. Yes.
There's the big oak tree out back.
Okay.
And then that's the man cave.
There's the man cave, yes.
And there's Grady the shop dog.
We're Grady sitting, are we?
Yeah, I've been there for a while now.
He seems to be perfectly happy at home there.
Oh yeah, this is.
And why wouldn't he be? He has he has ground squirrels to chase.
No ground squirrels this year.
Chipmunks or?
No, what he chases is the neighbor's German Shepherd up and down the fence line.
Well, that's pretty ballsy.
It's a game they play.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And then there's another little brown dog she's got next door. It's called Sebastian. And he tries to get in on the act, too, but all he does is get kicked by the German Shepherd all the time. It's quite funny to watch.
Yeah, I can only so in the video there, and by the way, apparently it was making my crappy internet struggle a little bit, but that wasn't Mount Lassen that I was seeing off to the side of the bush.
Yeah.
Oh, it was?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So, like you said,
Mount Lassen, and then there's the other part of it too.
A little windy there?
Yeah. But that used to be one part of those two mountains, the Lassen being the bigger one, used to be part of a super volcano that was 20,000 feet tall.
All kinds of interesting noises this evening.
But that blew up years and years ago.
Yeah, as in not when anybody was around?
Yeah. Before man got here. You know what one of the big businesses here is?
What's that?
Mining lava rock.
Oh, like pumice?
Yeah. Big chunks of lava rock that come off the volcano ages, eons ago.
Yeah, the stuff.
They load them on a big truck with big side bins and everything, and then they'll come down Highway 36, is which way they take to go to Mount Lass, and they'll come down Highway 36 to go to the freeway, and they go somewhere with it. I don't know where they go.
Well, pumice is a good scouring agent. I know because if you buy a bar of lava brand soap, it'll pretty much take the better part of your hands off, scrubbing with it, because it's got, I mean, that was the selling point. It had ground up pumice in it.
Anyway, it's an industry here. And I don't really think about that too much, but I was going into town the other day and I passed one of the trucks.
So they're still doing it?
Oh, yeah. Constantly. They got a market for it somewhere, doing something with it. Where it goes from here, I have no idea. Well, let me tell you why I have the laptop.
Okay.
Judy got pissed off at it and says, I want a computer that will work like yours does.
Don't piss off Judy, Sparky. You'd think you'd know that by now.
So what happens, I had to give up the computer tower that was hooked to the HDTV in the front room and swap it out for the laptop, which still works with the HDTV. You just got to put something over the screen because the screen don't go dark on it. So I set her up with a regular PC computer in her room. Then I had to go buy another table for her room, too.
Well, of course.
Well, plus, I couldn't do that unless I had a new monitor for the man cave. So I upgraded the man cave from a 24 to a 27-inch monitor.
I've got one 27-inch monitor here in the studio. It's the main one that I look at during the program. And it makes life, well, it makes the stress on my eyes considerably less, or at least it feels that way. Because it's a big screen. Mm-hmm. You know, sitting less than 3 feet away, that's a whole lot of screen. Update on more volcanic rock. VT Blom tells me, Bob, basalt is also volcanic rock used for architecture. Yes, it is. The three primary volcanic rocks are basalt and pumice and obsidian. Because I came very close to having a minor in geology once upon a time because I was scared to death to take chemistry. Long story. But, yeah. So is Judy digging her new computer?
Yeah, she likes it because it works faster. All I had to do was take the laptop and run a bunch of tests and delete a bunch of stuff, and I got it working 100% better.
Well, I've been seeing, of course, this is all descriptive of something visual, but I've been seeing some intermittent buffering on the line that we use to send out the stream. And then last Friday night when I was filling in for Malloy, gizmo that we use to connect to Progressive Voices is usually rock solid, but I got to the last 2 minutes of the program and the last couple of ads, and then everything collapsed. And the program shut down, the stream shut down, and I was going, please don't let it be the gizmo, please don't let it be the gizmo, please don't let it be the gizmo. And it wasn't the gizmo, and it wasn't the fine folks up at Progressive Voices. It was my craptastic internet connection. And so the tech guy was out here earlier today, and he checked the line, and he said, yeah, one of those cable pairs is just It says that the trouble's 10,000 feet out the road, but the line terminates at your place. So he switched us over to a different cable pair, and I'm hoping that that solved the problem, because I don't like worrying. There's nothing that makes me crazier than having connectivity issues in the middle of a live program. That'll make you bark at the moon. So cross your fingers that everything will work. And, well, darn it, Darlene just told me I lost the stream for a few minutes. I heard my challenge was met. And I've seen a little buffering. That may not have been the end of the problem. Never a dull damn moment, you know.
You're golden on Skype.
Yeah, I mean, go figure. Let's see here. Oh, by the way, Brother Deacon Asa put a challenge on the table. Brother Deacon Asa said, since everyone's offering up challenges on the table, I'm going to pile on with my What About Bob Pilot High and Deep challenge. That's a hell of a challenge. There's 50 quid on the table if all other challenges get met. So all the other challenges got met, and there's $50 more, and that'll if that's met, then that'll take us down another 100, and we will then be below 200 bucks to finish the week. So thank you, Brother Deacon Asa. Thank you a ton. Let's check in. I haven't really had a chance to look and see who all's come to play this evening. Okay, well, let's jump in. Hey, Dustin, good to hear from you. I think that's going to be Dustin.
Yeah. Must not have a microphone, I guess. He's working. He's undercover at work.
That's always a possibility. Yeah. Okay, then. Hey, Steve, you there?
Oh, whoa.
Oh, there's Dustin. Okay. Hey, Dustin.
Yeah. Sorry about that. I had to find the unmute button. I'm lost in this new Skype setup on the mobile.
Yeah. All the new Skype setups suck air. So don't feel bad.
But it's a nice day here in Sacramento, that's for damn sure. Mornings are starting out a little bit cold, and then it gets nice and toasty in the afternoon. So, let's just see how long it takes before the rain set in.
Yeah, we'll cross fingers. I mean, it got downright nippy here. It is at present a balmy 71 degrees here in the fabulous Horn Studios at the magnificent Kincaid Mansion. And it was like down in the 40s this morning. We are not far from first frost. And then after that, it's downhill to freeze your ass off.
Yeah, I think people were saying last night it was getting down to like 40, 45. Which, when you're looking at 85 to 90 degrees during the day, that's going to leave some people cold.
But you know where it's nice and warm and it's not particularly appreciated is down on the Florida Gulf Coast. Nice and toasty.
Oh. Yeah, what are they looking like now?
Oh, it looks like a war zone. If there's any good news to be had out of it, they decided it was not necessary to set up a temporary mortuary, .. yet. But lots of warnings are going out to people telling them, hey, learn how to use your generator before you try to use your generator. Hey, really, please be careful with the goddamn chainsaws. And no, really, if you see a down power line, don't touch it.
Because... Oh, wow.
Because people have a way of getting electromocuted. And if you've seen the photos, it's stunning. And just, by the way, for those who heard the Malloy program last night, I had a great conversation with Jeff Biggers about his new book, Resistance. And he published an article today. Go over to Common Dreams, commondreams.org, and look for his article. And it's a brilliant thought piece. We need cities of resistance. Climate adaptation is no longer an option. And this is a direct, I don't know if y'all remember me talking about it at the beginning of the week, but I was asking what does responding to climate change in an emergency all hands on deck way mean? What does a climate change future look like? Because when I start thinking about it, it kind of creeps me out and it's all scary and stuff. But Jeff was a big help with that, so everybody run over to commondreams.org and read that article. And don't just read it as if you're being handed some sort of an answer. You're not. Read it and understand that it's a call to your own action, your own ideas, your own creativity. And again, we need cities of resistance. Climate adaptation is no longer an option. The idea being that human beings cannot adapt to living in the world that climate change is going to bring to us. So, it's well worth the time. And, it doesn't matter if you're in Sacramento like Dustin or in the hills and hollers of almost level West Bicol Trump Virginia stand like me. The issue is relevant to every human being in this country. And it helps, that it doesn't, make you just want to go out and have Congress with a tailpipe or anything. Yeah. Sorry, I didn't mean to walk all over you there, Dustin.
That's all right. I always enjoy listening to your end about that sort of stuff. Or, in general. Jeez.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, I totally lost my train of thought.
I do that to people. That's my bad.
That's all right. But no, after listening to you for how long now, finally I decide, okay, let's say hi, see what's going on.
Yeah, I'm tickled pink. Sometimes it takes years for people to work up the courage to jump into the conversation, and then they find out, hey, this ain't so difficult.
Well, and I just came from 7-Eleven, so, once I see my deposit on PayPal, I'm going to try and meet somebody's challenge.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Dustin. Thank you very, very kindly. Let's see. Something else just rolled in. Thank you to Frank. That means there's $20 left in Brother Deacon Ace's challenge. Thank you, Frank. And we may get this knocked out yet. That's awesome. So, Dustin, how long you think you've been listening?
I think I started listening probably 2013, 14, somewhere in there.
Yeah,
it was right before my ex-wife decided to actually file the paperwork on me. But I don't recall how long before that.
Wow, that's a hell of a way to have to remember it.
Seriously.
Yeah. And,
I've been listening 9 years plus.
Yeah, every bit of it, and it wasn't that much longer after you jumped into the community, Sparky, that the Skype group was born, was it?
Nope, it was born pretty quick after that, but it was born because of the old chat room that Malloy had.
Yeah.
Because it had the old chat room Malloy had a feature on a docking feature which allowed people to talk to each other, and then from there the Skype group was born.
And in its earliest incarnations, it was a gathering that started. Well, this is back when like on the White Rose stream, Malloy would go up to midnight, and then my rerun would play. And so people would get together at about midnight Eastern time and chat, until the wee tiny small hours of the morning.
Oh, we saw the sun come up a couple times.
Well, yeah, I saw it come up here and then waited for 3 hours later, the sun came up on y'all.
Yeah, but it took you a couple of years to get active in the group.
Yeah, it did. Well, because, you know, it made Saturdays a little rough. You know, because when you're falling asleep at 4 o'clock and, you know, getting up at 8 or 7 or something like that, it's, well, you really didn't go to bed.
Yeah, and it starts at midnight, your time. But we used to have quite a few people.
Oh yeah, and there are a few people. There are a few people out there. Tony and Chico's one of them. David in South Carolina, Stan is one of them, and I think Steve's one of them, who actually listened off and on from all the way back in the terrestrial radio days.
Terrestrial days.
Yeah.
Yes. I remember when you had commercials. I found you. I was just frantically looking for a progressive voice out there. You know, after being bombarded with all these right-wing crazies, and I did a search and came up with a site listed about 20 progressive voices, and you happened to be one of them, and that's how I discovered you. Wow, this guy's talented. He's got it.
Aw, thanks.
But how long ago was that, Bob, when you were...
Well, that's the thing. The horn's actually older than 15. Its earliest incarnations go back to me hijacking Dr. Bill's program in May of 2003.
Do you remember, are you even allowed to say the call letters of the radio station that you used to broadcast on?
Oh, sure, but I don't want to give them the free ad.
Oh, okay. Well, you can just text it to me then. I'm sure I remember, but I can't come up with it now.
It was named, part of the call sign was the initials of the guy who owned it and went on to become a member of Congress. And then they turned it into, and then it got bought and was turned into a right-wing cesspool. And that's where I found it.
So that's when you parted ways or got your walking papers?
Oh, no. They were a right way. No, Dr. Bill and I actually, ratings-wise, pulled it out of the toilet. Because it was nothing but a bunch of right-wing garbage. There, it's in the chat, Steve.
Oh, okay, well... I'm out in the living room on the recliner, so...
Living the life of leisure.
Yeah, not by choice. Not by choice. But do you miss... which format do you prefer, Bob?
Oh, this. This.
Hands down.
In fact, I was having a conversation with another progressive talker the other day. And oddly enough, imagine this. There are actually two liberal progressive talk hosts who come from my little bitty corner of the neck of the woods, and we were talking about having to deal with right wing assholes, and I said that one of the best things that ever happened to me was when we started this, and I just said they're not going to be allowed because they ruin everything that we're trying to do here, because this is a conversation that's based on good faith, and right wingers have no good faith arguments. They have no good faith suggestions. You know, around 2003, 2004, you'd say something like, you know, we need to do, you know, we need to provide health care for everybody in this country, and the right wing response to that was, you commie. So. And that remains a problem, Steve. You cannot carry on a good faith conversation with these pricks. Maybe that means
right.
I'm not in good.
Back then, you had to take dissenting calls, correct? Or they encouraged you to, probably.
Well, just it's local radio. You take whatever comes.
Right. And you had a producer and all that, or?
Oh yeah.
Well, I'm sure you did. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh yeah. And you know, you just take them as they come, but it was, you know, and it was like gladiatorial combat, and it might be entertaining. And you know, we've had this conversation in this community, and I've kind of stuck to my guns on it. It might be entertaining, in the way that gladiatorial combat. In the way that gladiatorial combat's entertaining, or the way that wrestling is entertaining, but it doesn't accomplish anything.
I've heard you chew up a few ruddies before back in the day. It is highly entertaining for the listener, but for you, it's probably hell.
Well, it's just such a monumental waste of time, because again, you're not going anywhere. They're just time vampires.
Feel like a mouse on one of those wheels, probably.
Yeah, and you know, there's so much right-wing media out there. Why do they feel like, and the reason they want to waste your time is because you have so little of it. You know, think about the way, for instance, that Brett Kavanaugh answered questions in the Senate. He wouldn't answer the question put to him, and then he'd filibuster some sort of bullshit right-wing talking point. And all he was trying to do was run out the very limited time that the Democratic senators had. It was all in bad faith. So, I mean, that's, at least that's how I view it.
Well, back then, there was a lot of progressive voices, and they've all went away, and yours is one of the few that is still out there. You know, I remember Enid Goldstein. I don't know if you remember her. She was out of Colorado.
Yeah, Enid.
Very, very talented. Jerry Klein used to go head-to-head with some right-wing tool every Sunday. That was entertaining. I mean, they would go at it.
Well, just think about what we had going on the Horn. At one point in time at the Horn, we had 2 hours less per day of live programming than Air America. Ponder that for a minute. And we ran it on nothing.
Yeah. Shoestring budget, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, a lot of the commercials, weren't they like public service announcements?
Oh, sure, sure.
Yeah, I remember that, yep. And let's see, what else was that? The rant with Scooter, he disappeared. Bernie Ward, he went to jail. That was tragic. There was a lot of talent out there, though, at one time.
Well, I mean, even just here, we had Joe Vecchio, we had Guy James, me, Dr. Bill, Peter Godbold, Bruce Birch, John Fox, and, you know, right there is about 17 hours of programming.
Sure.
At the same time that Air America was hemorrhaging $80,000 a day. Right.
What they say progressive radio won't sell, that's bullshit. It won't sell because there's no market. They won't put it out there. Clear Channel's gobbled up everything, which they're now defunct. Hell, I don't even know who owns it now. Salem Radio, and everything's sports.
Yeah, and any time, there were a few efforts to put together progressive radio stations, and every time one of them succeeded, they suddenly found themselves being turned into sports talk radio or Jesus radio, because they were only put on in the first place because the right-wing owners of those stations assumed that a progressive station would hemorrhage money and lose in the book. And then when it didn't, it meant that it was profitable. And, well, that means that it's not the loss leader that the tax accountant said to put it up there to be. Of course, that, you know, the demise of Air America is a legendary screw up.
Piss poor management from the get go.
Well, and a terrible strategy. We're going to buy time on other radio stations. No, what you do is you start buying radio stations. If you don't own the license, you can't make the money. And then there was some dirty business down the line where there was what lawyers would refer to as tortious interference with business relations, where the station owners would say, Well, that's fine. We'll sell them the time, but don't run their goddamn ads. And so that meant that they couldn't make any money.
There was method to their madness.
Oh, sure, Prince. There was. So,
yeah.
You know, I'm proud of the fact 15 years on, we're one of the last ones standing.
Still standing, yeah.
And we've been here consistently. And you know, that's why I get all stressed out, you know, about the fundraising. I hate the fundraising model that we run on here.
I
despise it. But it's the only way I know of to keep it running, because if we could have run this thing on love, we would have had a budget surplus of that a long time ago. But I can't convince internet service providers and phone companies and power companies and the people who haul away the trash and you know, et cetera, to accept our Laurel and Hardy handshake in exchange for providing those things. And I can't, I don't like, you know, I mean, look, anybody that wants the program can get it. And we put it all over the place. Contrary to most business models, we put it all over the place. You can get it on Roku. You can get it on Stitcher. You can get it on TuneIn. You can get it at the head-on.live stream. You can get it at the White Rose stream. You can get it over at FYI. You can get it on YouTube. You can get it at iTunes. You can, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. When the more accepted strategy is to put it in one place and make everybody come there. But we wanted to do something different, Steve. We wanted to create something that was available to anybody who wanted it anytime they wanted it. Not because anybody here was looking to get rich, because nobody ever is. But because we felt like the conversation itself was the coin of the realm. And so, come 12 days from now, we will have been succeeding at it for 15 years. Now, that's nothing compared to, say, the 35-plus that Malloy's got in.
Yeah, he was in Chicago at one time, wasn't he?
Atlanta, Chicago, IE America, yeah. Air America, Nova M, all of... But
WSB and would go head to head with Neil Bortz. They'd have like a point counterpoint way back in the day.
Oh Jesus, Neil Bortz.
Yeah, fish head, man. And Mike chew him up every day. It was highly entertaining.
Somebody needs to induct Mike into the Broadcasting Hall of Fame. Because
I would argue you as well, but
nah.
You don't like that kind of talk.
No, not me. But Mike absolutely, because, you know, Mike marched into Chicago and owned the book. Just slaughtered him. But again...
IE Radio Network? Worked
for No. What was it? WLS? Yeah. Because I used to catch him on WLS.
Independent. It was an independence, like IE.
Yeah, that American. Was, but that was after. Yeah. That was after Chicago. That was after.
Right, it was after Chicago. Yep.
But on WLS, he smoked. He smoked every other station.
He could rip right wingers to shreds too. I mean, just have him for lunch, man. But he's like you. He doesn't want to waste his time anymore. Doesn't want to suffer fools, I guess.
Well, it may be fun for the audience, but it's no fun for the person doing it, because it is a waste of that person's time. And, you know, at the end of every program, I talk about our precious finite time. I don't believe there's a second act.
Right.
I don't believe you get pie in the sky when you die.
Mm-mm.
So whatever, you know, if there are people out there who find this conversation to be valuable and join in night after night after night, I owe a profound debt of gratitude for sharing that time and sharing the ideas. It's not thanks for taking my call, Bob. It's me thanking y'all for engaging in it. And it's just a different philosophical approach. David in South Carolina.
You're one of the few hosts I've ever heard turning around like that.
Well, I can't afford the monumental ego of a dickhead like Rush Limbaugh. With half my brains tied behind my back. All right, hand me another handful of those goddamn pills. It's bullshit.
Randy claims to have kicked his ass in the West Palm Beach demographic, and I believe her.
Oh, I have no doubt.
He pouted up and had a fit and said, look, either her or me, one of us has got to go. Because his male ego couldn't stand the fact that he was getting his ass kicked.
By a girl. Yeah. David in South Carolina, Stan, says, I picked it up on the old radio show somehow long time ago. Yeah, I would get emails from David in South Carolina, Stan, when I was there on the terrestrial air. So, yeah.
I used to stream it on a 28 baud modem, yeah. Back in the day. Wow.
Ning, 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 ning.
And you get booted at least 8 or 10 times a night. Oh. AOL was hell, man. Oh, God. Let's not even go there.
Well, let me say that we are making tremendous progress. Brother Deacon Ace's challenge has been met. And then some. And let me see here. I'll be able to give a number for where we got to get to. I think we are about... we're about $180 out from finishing the evening. So that's tremendous. This wasn't necessarily about, you know, talking about the history of the horn or anything. It actually occurred to me that, yeah, hey, our birthday's coming up. And so I thought I would go ahead and mention that. But that isn't necessarily what's on people's minds. Steve, has anything got a burr under your saddle or a bee under your bonnet?
My birthday's coming up, too.
That is true. It's same month, right?
Next Friday night.
Yeah. So,
next Friday.
Well, scheduling-wise, you'll probably get the night off, Sparky. Because you can go and you and Judy can go out and celebrate somewhere. Because
we ain't going nowhere.
Ah, now, dadgummit, don't be a killjoy. I mean, granted, you don't have an okay Chinese buffet out there like I do. But got to be something. But yeah, next Friday night will be the night before Bridge Day. And so there are festivities involved, and this is the last, you know, yeah. It's the last gasp of fun before the weather turns to shit. So I figure,
take it.
I think I'm going to take a rare Friday night off, we'll go out and do some pre-Bridge Day stuff, and hopefully the weather will cooperate enough to, let me do stuff with the smoker. Because I'm really hell bent on making that chili.
But you're not going to enter the contest because you have to make a minimum of 5 gallons. And
oh God, it's five
too
or ten.
Much like work.
Well, jeez. It's not. It's not just this. Since I'm on this side of the river and they shut the bridge down. Getting across the river, you either have to go over there and spend the night and sleep on somebody's floor or something, or, you know, you get up at the Sparrow's Fart and creep through the traffic to find a parking place, and then you got to haul everything out and you got to set up a tent. No, I just like a good pot of chili.
No, it's not worth it. Just for bragging rights, unless there's a pile of money involved, you know.
And there isn't.
Bragging rights? No. Burr up my saddle. I did see Fox and Fiends this morning, interviewed some guy that said what a genius guy, the is.
Oh, the?
Yeah.
What the entire fuck? What?
Yeah, he said what a genius he was, and how what a joy it was to have two financial wizards sharing the same room together. I'm like, you've got to be kidding me. Hi, Tracy. What's on your mind?
You got the mic. What's your beef? Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Between Kanye's rant and then Arnold Schwarzenegger saying that, you know, he stepped over the line with women, but, you know, I didn't really do anything wrong. So fucking your maid, getting her pregnant, having her lie and saying that the baby is her husband's child. Yeah. So is her name, was her name Sally Hemings?
Wait a minute. You didn't.
Yes, I did.
Yeah, you did. Wait a minute. Yeah.
Bring it, Bob.
I mean, seriously? When I heard that, I was going to text you, but I was so mad when I heard that on the radio. I was screaming, but I couldn't text you to say, wait, what? It's like, because I was driving, and I'm like, this motherfucker here, a man who's in a position of power, he's her employer. He had sex with her. Now, I don't know if it was consensual, but chances are it wasn't. Not, you know, and, you know, she might have said yes, but under duress, because it's like, if I say no, do I keep my job kind of thing? You know? But you don't see anything wrong in that. Okay.
You know, you remind me of a question. Would it be wrong to maybe get a sound clip of what you talking about, Willis, for moments like that?
Yes, what you talking about, Willis? Seriously. It's like, wow. I mean, and the only reason why he's even saying anything about I've stepped over the line a few times with women is because he doesn't want to get called out. He's doing a preemptive strike?
Yeah, that's it.
And it's the environment we find. It's the environment we find ourselves in as well, with Trump and, you know, everybody out there demeaning women just constantly. I fear we're going to get numbed down to it. Well, I won't personally, but.
Hey, Bob, did you watch that clip that I sent you? Trevor Noah did about Trump and this thing about how men are playing the victim card now.
Yeah, I did. And also the Don Lemon panel.
Oh, that was, wasn't that beautiful?
Agnes was in the room with me when I played that. And when she gets genuinely tickled, it is like, I don't know. It's like some sort of angelic music. Because,
well, that was awesome. I mean, Don Lemon almost peed in his pants. He was laughing so hard, right? But when that brother says, Kanye is what happens when Negroes don't read, oh, my God. And the white, but the best part was the white boy on the panel, because he was around. It was
well, no, white dude knew that there was, that he was in dangerous country.
Right. He's like, I'm not even going to talk. I'm just going to sit here.
Well, how many times on this program?
Don Lemon say it was a.
How many times on this program?
Show.
Yeah. How many times on? Yeah. How many times on this program, Tracy? Have I said, "Well, you said that, I can't."
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
White guy. Yeah. White guy, going to be quiet now.
Right.
Well, because
that's why I quoted Don Lemon.
The panel that we're talking about on that I sent Bob was before the minstrel show, so this was, you know. Panel. So this was before the minstrel show, and the one that you're talking about, Don Lemon calling Kanye the minstrel show. That was two different shows.
Yeah, in fact, I've got the clip here. Let's just enjoy it for a minute.
Sure.
Do let's.
Kanye West is what happens when Negroes don't read.
Hold on. There we go.
And so Kanye West is what happens when Negroes don't read. And we have this now, and now Donald Trump is going to use it and pervert it, and he's going to have somebody who can stand with him and take pictures.
Just looking at Scott's face. Scott's like, whoa, okay. So
Scott's white, dude. And yeah, he is. He's just sitting over there. Probably better not. And you know, you get this is, well, you get to use the Richard Pryor white man voice.
Right.
I don't think I'd better say anything here.
It's a Chris Rock reference, by the way, Scott. Go back and watch the old Chris Rock stand-ups from the 90s.
Maybe
I will look that up.
I know that. All right, listen.
I'll look it up.
Tara, will it? I don't know.
Work for who? It's not going to work in the black community. Listen, black folks are about to trade Kanye West in the racial draft, okay? They've had it with him. He's not the same.
Whoa! Content. I do know that reference. I know that. Oh. That is an old Dave Chappelle skit. I know
there
that
you
one.
Go.
I got
that one.
All right, good. I'm one for two. All right, keep going.
But seriously, I mean, this is not the Kanye West of 2004. This isn't the College Dropout album guy.
Yeah.
This is not. And what's funny to me is to watch all of these white people behind Donald Trump clapping away at the name of Kanye West when it wasn't that long ago that Kanye West said that George W. Bush doesn't like black people.
Doesn't care.
After Hurricane Katrina. Yeah. And, you know, Kanye, but now all of a sudden Kanye, because he's put on a MAGA hat and he's an attention whore like the president, he's all of a sudden now the model spokesperson. He's the token Negro of the Trump administration. This is ridiculous. And no one should be taking Kanye West seriously. He's clearly has issues. He's already been hospitalized. You know, not to trivialize mental health issues, but, I mean, obviously Kanye has taken a turn in a very strange way. You read any of his interviews, go back and reread his interview with Charlemagne the God, it's all over the place. So this is not exactly the best representation, to Bakari's point, especially on an issue as important as prison reform. There's a lot of other people who are much more well-versed on this issue that are serious.
That pretty much covers it.
See, and the sister is a black conservative. So when a black conservative,
wait, really?
Bad, yes, she's a conservative strategist, a Republican strategist. Yes, she is.
Well, you know, I mean, I guess that's a good corner to work, because there ain't just a whole lot of traffic on it.
No, but she's a true believer, okay. So when a black conservative is pissed off at another black person for showing their ass on national television, she's like, oh no, we want to get rid of Kanye. We're done with Kanye, okay? Because Kanye needs to go sit down. And then today Don Lemon, his whole thing was like 30 minutes of his show was about Kanye West. And I think I've said this. I don't know if I have said it, but before Kanye West has always and will always be an asshole. But at least when his mother was alive, he was semi-bearable, okay? Because his mom kept him in check. But when his mother died, he went completely off the deep end. He lost. Because his mom apparently was the one that kept him making sure he was taking his meds and all that. You know, she kept him in check. But then once she passed away, you know, because she was having, you know, elective surgery, you know, at a certain age, honey, you don't need boobs, okay? Anyhow, and anything that's going to cost me my life, potentially I'm not going under the knife. That's just me. But anyway, that's how she died. She had a... she got sick or something after she had breast implants. So anyhow, I digress. But ever since she died, there's something just snapped in him. And if Don Lemon even brings that out in today's interview, today's thing, because he's like when he was watching it as a black person, it was cringeworthy. He said he couldn't watch the whole thing, because I watched a couple of minutes of it today, and I had to stop.
because it hurt me to my very core to see this. I mean, like he said, it was a minstrel show.
Well, yeah, and you're not smart-assing that, Tracy. I mean, you know the history, so when you see somebody doing the fawning, obsequious, self-abasing stuff that involves terms that I'm just not comfortable using.
How's Negro, Uncle Tom, coon, okay.
Sellout.
Sellout. You know.
Hey.
It hurt me because, see, especially coming from me, because I know what it's like to have mental health issues. I have been battling, I am bipolar, so I know those demons, okay? And I know what happens when I don't take my meds, okay? I mean, I don't go that crazy. I mean, trust me, if I got off my meds,
and God forbid.
Off my meds, I know the fuck that I wouldn't be in the White House. That's for goddamn sure, okay? So that's not going to happen. You know, I might be in Vegas for a whole week, but that's a whole nother situation. But I just like
that's the manic. Off. That's the manic side, right?
That's the manic side. You know,
because the other side of that mountain is. You also might be, you know, in bed with the shades drawn for 3 weeks.
Yes, exactly. And you guys do know, because you love me, when I disappear, you know what's going on. You know, when it's gone for months and you haven't heard from me. And it's like, okay, something's happening with Tracy, because I've been very open about, you know, my mental health. So that is why, you know, like what Don Lemon was saying today, who's in charge of Kanye? Because if these people really cared about Kanye, they would not let him do what he's doing. They would keep him in check. Just like if anybody truly cared about Donald Trump, his family, when he goes off the deep end, they would rein his ass in. But they don't care. Because they're getting exactly what they want. So why should we rein them in? You know, he's making a fool of himself, you know, for Kanye, and he's getting all this attention and stuff like that. Trump is leading the country down a deep, dark crevice. So he and giving the rich everything they want, and the oil companies and all these other things, everything they want. So why the fuck should we do anything about it? Because we don't care. We're getting exactly what we want. I'm just saying.
Well, the way you describe that is it's pure, unadulterated exploitation.
Yes.
I mean,
exactly.
Does anybody know who the old dude was sitting next to McCain? Kind of resembled Bill Cosby. Is that one of his handlers?
No, you know, Bob. That was Jim Brown.
Oh, okay.
Oh, okay. And then so that clip that you played a little while ago with her name is Tara, but I forget what her last name is. I think. So apparently, we got another sellout Negro, Herschel Walker. So he went on a Twitter tirade against. Calling for Don Lemon to get fired because of the racist things he was saying about Kanye. Now, granted, if you watch, like you just played the interview, did Don Lemon say anything?
No.
No. So why should he be fired? Oh, because he was laughing. And it's like, well, the shit was funny. Okay? And so...
And you know what? There was a reference there to 90s Chris Rock routines. And I've never really known how to deal with it, because Chris Rock's routines have some pretty rough material dealing with his own community.
Yeah.
The black community. And as a white guy, I said, you know, and he said, you know, What's the line? There's always some boop got to ruin it for the rest of us.
Rest of us, right?
And as you want to talk about being whitely uncomfortable. It's when you're sitting there and you're just being bombarded with this hilarious comedy, and at the same time, you're kind of going, I don't think I'm allowed to laugh at this.
Right. Well, and it's like, and see, when you said, you know, and I'm going to, you know, there's always this one nigga that got to ruin for the rest of us. And there's, and there you go, there's Kanye. Because like I said yesterday, was it yesterday in the text that I said? Oh, yeah, because it was yesterday. And I'm like, what the entire fuck? And it's like, it's always the one. It's like he set black people back 300 years. He really did. And like, and then to attribute the fact how little and how demeaning white people and Republicans think of black black Americans, that they think that cutting somebody out like Kanye West is going to lend themselves to supporting Donald Trump. It's like, well, we got Kanye, so of course now black people are going to support Donald Trump. Because, you know,
and yet, but yet, okay, what a beautiful transition into questions of both intellect and privilege. And yet, at the same time, white folks in Texas are probably still burning their old Willie Nelson 8-tracks because, mm-hmm. you know, white wing white folks.
Right. And the chicks.
They're probably still burning their will because, you know, how dare he not support the Republican?
Right.
Yeah.
I got a funny Willie story if you want to hear it.
Oh, yeah. Go ahead.
Well, today I'm going to the mailbox, and the people across the street are getting their roof redone. They tore off the roof themselves, and then the guys from the roofing supply were there with the big boom conveyor belt that puts the roofing material on the roof. Well, there's a burly guy, no shirt on. He's got a big old hat to protect himself from the sun. Wide brim hat. People that know me, I have a ponytail, and I wear bandanas like Willie. So the guy sees me watching him, and he yells across the street. He says, "What's going on, Willie?"
Did he mean it as a compliment?
Well, that's the impression he saw me standing there, and he thought of Willie Nelson.
Right.
Because of the way I look, my stepson has called me Willie quite a few times. Except I don't braid my hair yet.
I was going to ask. I haven't seen the braid down to the middle of your back yet.
No, but I mean, I got a ponytail that goes down halfway down my back.
Well, you know what?
I look like one of the extras on The Outsiders.
Well, so now, in exchange for all the work you did on the computer, just get Judy to braid your ponytail. And then we'll call that going the full Willy. except for the fact that sounds a little filthy.
That sounds a little dirty, Bob.
I got to go to rescue Grady. He stepped on a thorn.
Oh! Ow. That hurts just thinking about it. Yeah, Steve in New York just pointed, he's not in New York, he's in Canada now, said, I think Dave Chappelle's even worse. Ever seen the Clayton Bigsby skit? Oh, yes.
Oh, yes.
And again, you're sitting there going, is it okay for me to laugh at this? Because I really want to laugh at this.
Well, see, and see, this is the beautiful thing about comedy, because even me, when, you know, I mean, it's things are definitely different as far as racial matters in this country, and people are becoming more aware, but we still all have bias, you know, biases. And so everybody within their own community there's, you know, that we find things problematic within our own community. And comedians tend to use what they know in their comedy, be it, you know, pain or what's happening, you know, the crack epidemic, you know, poverty, whatever it could be in the Black community. And that's what you use for your comedy. You know, drug addiction, all sorts of stuff. I mean, and then you take that and somehow you turn it into comedy gold. Everybody can't do that. You know,
We were talking about Richard the other night, and that was part of his genius. You know, there was it's almost like there was a sort of little miniature social contract with his work. I remember early on in the live recording, Richard Pryor wanted live in concert.
Ooh, yes.
And I think they recorded it in D.C. Because at one point he says, yeah, we're in D.C., dark country. But apparently he could see beyond the floodlights and the footlights, and at one point in time, he declares, "Oh my God, white people!" Because apparently, you know, some white folks were walking down to walk into their seats, and like I said, there was kind of a contract going on there that it was okay if they laughed, if the white folks laughed when he said things that maybe we weren't sure we were supposed to, as long as we understood that he was going to laugh at us, too.
Oh, yeah.
Well, and, Bob, didn't Dick Gregory and Red Fox sort of pioneer that style of comedy? If you want to trace the trail back?
I think Dick Gregory certainly did. Red Fox, for as brilliant as he was, you know, he was more...
He wasn't social.
Yeah, he was more like a black, dirty Henny Youngman.
Right. No, his stuff was there was no I don't because I've listened to some of the old Red Fox stuff, and I don't remember there being any social commentary on it. Like you said, that was more Dick Gregory's thing. Who was definitely brilliant. He was way ahead of his time, you know. But yeah, no, it's just, you know, when I hear, like I said, it was about Herschel. Herschel Walker went on a Twitter tirade, and the sister, like I said, I can't remember her name, Tyra, I think, clapped back. She did the Black woman, you know. And when you say, like, and I don't know, have you guys ever seen this? This is when a Black woman is upset enough and you're not listening to her and she has to get your attention and she does the hand clap to accentuate each syllable. I told you what this is what I meant to say.
And oh, Lord, yes.
To me, you know, I've been trying to talk to you in such a way that you understand me, but obviously, as what was that? Who was that in Cool Hand Luke? What we have here is a failure to communicate.
Mm-hmm.
So now I got to do the hand clap. What is your problem? You know, and I hate
the first time I ever heard that, Tracy.
What?
When I was in sixth grade. and you know, I started out there in Alabama. My little birth year was the first to begin in integrated schools. So, you know, we went to school together from grade one. In sixth grade in my little school, we got our first African American teacher.
Ooh.
And she taught language arts. And she taught language arts with extreme prejudice.
Okay, and would you? I mean, the fact that you still
remember I ever experienced that was in sixth grade English.
And see, it makes it.
I before E except after C. Yeah, so. Yeah, I speak that. And God, I loved her. Because she sounds
amazing.
Oh, she was. She was. And that's the thing. My first male teacher was in sixth grade. My elementary years were a series of brilliant women. And for the most part, all the way up through high school, not that many male teachers.
No, not back in the day. It was mostly women.
And so, you know, this idea, it's like what we were talking about with wet nursing and white folks, all these men out there, you know, I'm a self-made man. Oh, blow me.
Kiss my black ass. Well, you can't say kiss my black ass.
Kiss my very white ass, yes.
Like I was telling a friend of mine the other day, when I was waiting for the young lady that I drop off in the morning, so I have to wait for her TA to come out to get her off the cab, right? And one of the TAs walked by me, and it made me think of you because you talk about how white you are, that you're not really white, you're pink. And this woman, she was so white. And the only thing I could think of was you, is how you basically said that if you turn, when you open the refrigerator, you could get a sunburn from the light bulb in the
right,
refrigerator.
Right, yeah. It's hell. We have to keep solar cane around just in case I need a midnight snack.
Right, exactly. I mean, she was just that white. And she had that blonde hair that wasn't even blonde. It was just white.
Corn silk.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, see, I don't get to say kiss my white ass. I have to say kiss my translucent ass.
You're translucent. I mean, it's just like, wow. I'm like, you know, talk about, you know, it's like, ooh. But no, it's like, with Trump. No, okay, so even if he said, my dad only gave me $1 million. Now, that's $1 million in 1970s money, for one thing. Even if it was only $1 million. How are you self-made? If a motherfucker gives you $1 million.
Yeah, not hardly.
Okay, and it's like Jan's brother, he's another one of these assholes that says the same thing. He neglects to mention that his dad gave him like a $50,000 quote-unquote loan back in the 60s to get his business started. But, you know, I'm a self-made man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Trump was a millionaire at 8 years old.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, and look.
How are you self-made when you were born into money, motherfucker? How?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, he was
on payroll 3 years old. Get $200,000.
He fell out of his mother's birth canal onto a pile of money, okay? They dabbed him dry with money.
Right. He uses money. He could use money, dollar bills for toilet paper if he wanted to. So it's like, come on, player. When you say, no, see, a self-made motherfucker is a motherfucker that gets up and he starts from nothing. He starts from nothing. He's the one that, you know, starts off in the mailroom in corporate America and works his way all the way up to CEO, okay? When you can still do that shit. You know, the motherfucker that, you know, comes from extreme poverty and goes to college against all odds and makes it out of college and becomes something from there. Those are self-made people. Okay, or better yet, a self-made motherfucker is the motherfucker that gets up every morning and make and can still keep a roof over his head, food in the house, and clothes on him and his family's back, and still survive in this economy. That's a self-made man. How about that?
So I'm a self-made man, then.
You damn sure are.
You damn sure are. And I.
So's Rick.
You know, that shit just popped in my head just now. I'm like, in this economy, anybody that is whose head is above water is a self-made man.
Well, Tracy, you know, we were talking about the origins of some of the stuff here on the Horn, and you just tapped into one of them. You know, I refer to the little panel we have here on Fridays as the Extraordinary Ordinary Roundtable.
Right.
Because it's nothing to go into the for-profit media and see roundtable discussions, you know, like the McLaughlin group.
Right.
Of you know, millionaires sitting there talking about how to solve this or that problem. But most of those people could not survive a day, 2 days, 3 days walking around in the shoes of the people who really make America go.
Exactly.
Because the people who make America go are not the goddamn, it's not the CEOs and the CFOs and the COOs.
No.
It's the people who get up and go to work every day, like it or not, sick or well, hope the goddamn tire doesn't blow out, hope the transmission doesn't fall out, because then you are well and truly fucked. And somehow or another, manage to be a mom, a dad, a husband, a wife, and at the same time, sell the precious finite time of their existence to a bidder who is underpaying them where they work. That is, and you know, over the years, I cut back on the number of so-called experts we have on this program, because the real experts, and you know, the more people join in these conversations, the better, because as far as I know, this is the only radio program that says that the experts are the people we don't hear from. Now, am I talking about somebody with a terrible case of economic anxiety who's one stubbed toe away from screaming the N-word till it can be heard on the moon, and that's why they voted again Hillary? No, I'm not. But I am talking about people who operate in good faith and want a future for this country and a future for their children, their grandchildren, and their great-grandchildren, and don't think that they themselves are the be-all and end-all of existence, because that's the bottom line with conservatism and the white wing. They think it's all about them, and they're going to live forever, and nobody else matters. That's why we're in this goddamn mess with climate change we're in. Because a whole bunch of right-wing conservatives said, yeah, but I won't be rich. I won't be richer tomorrow than I was today if we start having to worry about all the carbon we're pumping into the atmosphere and the planet that we're heating up. And you can't get through to them because they're so blinded by their fucking avarice that you can't say to them, hey, dumbass, no planet, no economy, no planet, no wealth. Or, you know, and not even, that's just a shorthand, because I was railing about that. If the planet can't sustain human life, it can't sustain the people you need to make you rich.
Did you do, at the beginning of the show, did you do the 12 years, that we had 12 years to get this shit right?
No, I didn't. No. By the way, we got 12 years to get it. We got 11 years and... We back, let's see, so 365, 364.
You're doing math, Bob.
360. We got 11 years and 359 damn days. What are we doing about it? And that's why I reiterate that everybody does need to go out and read Jeff Biggers' book, Resistance. It is, I had a brilliant conversation last night with him on the Malloy program. And he provides a means for us to envision a future that will work. So,
the thing is, it is possible. It is absolutely, completely possible. Because if it wasn't possible, we wouldn't have the numbers, like you said, 11 years and 359 or whatever days before, you know, it's that song, it's the end of the world as we know it. You know, we have the technology, we have the power. You know, I feel like, what was the the $6 million man? It's not you, we have the technology. You know, we can do this. I mean, and it's simple shit. It's simple shit. Solar panels. Where's Spark? I'm going to say it. Windmills.
Oh, you done got on the wrong side of Sparky.
You done did it.
turbines. I know.
How many times do I gotta educate you? You can't mill electricity.
Sweetie, I know that. I'm just messing with you because it gets your dander up.
I know. Every day it's windy up here. I don't see that ridge line that just burned up here. I go, why ain't there windmills all along that ridge line?
I mean, it's so simple. And what kills me is the fact that if we use this technology, this renewable energy, how many people would be employed by this? You know, I thought...
Well, that's why last...
People were cold.
Who did that?
What?
Who did that?
Me. I'm going to play as end of the world as we know it.
Tracy, last night, Jeff was talking about Adelaide, Australia, where they turned around their city, they cut their carbon output, and they drove their employment rate through the roof because people needed green, they had to have people who knew how to do clean energy, green job technologies.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's right up there with the argument against the living wage. I mean, because Seattle was one of the first cities that did the mandatory $15 an hour, especially in restaurants where they don't pay, you know, it's this bullshit that the restaurant industry, you know, is only paying people like $2 or $3 an hour. And, you know, they're relying on tips. So now in Seattle, the restaurants have to pay the employees $15 an hour. And guess what? Their economy is doing just fine, Bob.
Sure. And you know what? The McDonald's in Copenhagen haven't shut down because, or Sydney, because people make an allegedly living wage making Big Macs.
Right.
And the price of the Big Mac is not that much different from what it is here. It's just a question of whose pocket it goes into.
Exactly. Well, it's like I was, this article, well, it was kind of like not even really an article, kind of a snippet talking about like Elon Musk and how dare you build a Tesla, you know, and you're, you know, purportedly about saving the environment and stuff, but you treat your employees like shit. You can't have it both ways. You know, you have to take care, because if you don't, if you're trying to take care of the environment, but you're not taking care of your employees. And that's the business model that, you know, him and, you know, like Jeff Bezos, this big deal about I'm paying my employees $15 an hour, but it's like, but then you took away their stock options.
Yeah, yeah. By the way, I want to go back to something that because you know you brought in the issue of mental health relative to the whole Kanye thing. If that thing serves any benefit at all, maybe it. Wow, this is a serious search for a ray of fucking sunshine. It triggers some of that. Of course, he'd have to admit that he needs help. But I had a note from Michael in Madison, subject line, Pete Davidson on Kanye. I don't know if you've heard this, I haven't, but it really speaks to what I'm hearing from Tracy. I'm not a huge Pete Davidson fan on SNL, but I thought this was really on point. He too has mental health struggles. It's just under 4 minutes. It was broadcast before this week's Oval Office minstrel show, but after the unaired SNL rant, from two weekends ago. As someone who also suffers from some mental health problems, I agree with Pete. It's no excuse to just act like a dick. So let's check this out.
Last week, Kanye West performed on the show, and afterwards he gave an unplanned speech to the audience in support of Donald Trump. Here with his reaction to Kanye's speech is Pete Davidson.
First off, a lot of people thought Che should be the one to talk about Kanye, but we discussed it, you know, because Che's black, but, like, I'm crazy, and we both know which side of Kanye is at the wheel right now. So, to a good start. So speaking strictly for myself, what Kanye said after we went off the air last week was one of the worst, like, most awkward things I've ever seen here. And I've seen Chevy Chase speak to an intern. And we all had to stand behind him. And here's what it looked like. So, like, I'm, like, on the left. I'm like, oh, God. And then I'm like, I want a career. So I leave. necessary. So Kanye was wearing a MAGA hat. That's what it's called. It's stupid. Yeah. And he started by saying people backstage tried to bully him into not wearing it. He wore it all week. Like, nobody told him not to wear it. Like, I wish I bullied you. I wish I would have suggested that, you know, it might upset some people, like your wife or every black person ever, you know? I wish someone bullied me into not wearing this hat.
Visual.
Can you imagine that that T-shirt was the second stupidest thing I was wearing? Then Kanye said that Democrats broke up black families with welfare, and that's slavery is not real. You know how wrong about politics you have to be for, like, me to notice? You know how annoying that is? Like, Kanye is a genius, but, like, a musical genius. You know, like, Joey Chestnut is a hot dog eating genius. You know, but I don't want to hear Joey Chestnut's opinion about things that aren't hot dog related.
There you go. Yes, I agree.
Thank you. But, like, Kanye, I know you're like, yo, this is the real me. I'm off the meds. Take them. There's no shame in the medicine game. I'm on them. It's great. Take them. There's nothing wrong with taking them. If I ever got on a plane and the pilot said, I just want all you to know, this is the real me flying. I'd jump out. Being mentally ill is not an excuse to act like a jackass. Okay? I'm quoting my therapist, my mom, and my mailman. Sorry, Carl. But no, seriously, one time I stopped taking my meds and I bit my mom. No, it's all good. I bought her a house.
All right, so is there anything Kanye can do to win you back?
Yeah, there is, and I'll tell you in a way that Kanye understands. I made this. Make Kanye 2006 again.
Pete Davidson, everyone.
And drop that album. Where's that album?
Can we get up there and tell the joke? I'm Michael Cherry. Where's that album?
I did pretty fair appraisal, don't you think?
Yes. It's okay. You guys know that I drive special needs children to and from school, and for a while I was the private driver for a young man that was had special needs. He was on the higher end of the autism spectrum, and when I first started driving him, you know, there was problems with his behavior, and basically I did the black mother thing, and I'm like, just because you have autism doesn't mean you could be, and basically I said that, but it's because you have autism doesn't mean you could be an asshole. It doesn't work that way. You know the difference between right and wrong. You know what you're doing to a certain extent. So don't pull that, well, I have autism, so that excuses my behavior. I can do whatever the hell I want to do. No, because you know enough that you can get away with stuff because you have autism. So you're like, well, I can do whatever I want because I have autism. It's the same thing with Kanye West. Okay, I have, you know, mental illness. Everybody knows it's been documented. I have talked about it. So that gives me a license to be an idiot. No, it does not. Take your fucking, okay, let me do the clap. Take your fucking
Oh, that's great, Tracy.
This is one of those nights that I wish we had a, I wish we were doing all 3 hours because this is the heart and soul of what Friday and from the Front
Porch.
Oh, that's
right. You got to leave early today.
Yeah, I do. But a couple of things. One, thanks to Hung Like Jesus, we have knocked it down to, we got about $150 to go to finish for the evening. And again, thanks to Dustin as well. That's how we got there. So we can finish off We can finish off the week with a Friday on the Front Porch community made miracle with another $150 or so, as best as I can cipher it. Let's see, a couple of there's Ralphs wandering into the chat room. Hey, Ralphs. Just because I got to throw this out there. I didn't talk about it on this program last night because I try not to overlap the stuff, you know, when I'm subbing for Malloy. I try not to do the same stuff on this program that I do on his. I want, you know, 4 hours of fresh material. And toward the end of the program last night, I got into the whole business with Brian Kemp in Georgistan and the dirty piece of work that he's perpetrating. I think he senses that he can't beat Stacey Abrams in a straight up fight. So he's going to try to steal the votes to keep her from getting into the, because we can't have Georgia having a black woman being the governor of the great state of Georgia. Jesus,
we can't have one of those people in our governor's mansion, right?
Right. Yeah, and so,
and he's in charge of counting the votes.
So he's right. So he's the Secretary of State, as Steve points out.
How does that work? How can he be? How can he be? Okay, there's nothing wrong with him running for governor, but how the fuck is he still Secretary of State?
Because nobody's made him. Because nobody's it's a constitutional office, and nobody can make him recuse himself.
It's American politics, Tracy. That's the way it is. The same thing happened with
somebody.
Blackwell
brought a lawsuit
in Ohio
today.
Well, there has been a lawsuit filed, but you know,
filed today. Yep. A little too late, don't you think?
Yeah.
But the fact that he is stealing, he's trying to steal the election. We're watching him do it in real time, and then you know, the only reason white-wing Republican politicians dog whistle is because dog whistling works. Okay, this is going to be a little test. How good are the rest of us at spotting white-wing dog whistles?
Oh, shit. It's almost as better than my gaydar.
Okay, so this will be easy. He made a statement about the fact that there's getting to be a whole bunch of attention paid to the dirty business he's about. I'm going to read that statement. Title, Georgia Shatters All-Time Voter Registration Record. Dateline, Hotlanta. Today, Secretary of State Brian Kemp announced that Georgia has shattered the all-time voter registration record with over 6,915,000 active and inactive voters on the rolls. Kemp expects the total number to break 7 million voters at any moment as counties continue to process forms received by yesterday's deadline. Quote, this is the test portion. Despite what you hear or read, the numbers are clear. While outside agitators disparage the office and falsely attack us, we have kept our heads down and remained focused on ensuring secure, accessible, and fair elections for all voters who are white. No, I added that last part. The fact is that it has never been easier to register to vote and get engaged in the electoral process in Georgia, and we are incredibly proud to report this new record. Anybody hear the dog whistle?
Mm-hmm.
Take it, Tracy.
So it's like, okay, so...
It's only two... God. Tracy, it's only two words.
I can't even talk right now. I'm tongue-tied. I'm sorry.
That's quite all right. The dog whistle is outside agitators.
The agitators, yeah. The outside agitators.
While outside agitators disparage this office, said Governor Wallace, said Lester Maddox.
Christ, that wasn't even subtle, was it?
No, not even trying to. In other words, I am running for governor of Georgia for the decent white people. Because we got to keep Georgia decent and white.
And white.
And I heard that story. What the actual...
What the entire fuck, Bob. Get it right.
Yes. And so he is being sued today. Steve's right. The question is, can we do anything about it? But there's one thing that needs to be known, remembered in this whole transaction. It ain't just Brian Kemp. Because that whole exact match thing that's the source of all of this, because, say, you know, Deputy County Clerk Marvelline there in the Coweta County Clerk's office, who's in charge of voter registration and is about 97 years old. Well, she don't know if Tamika is spelled with an I and a Q or two E's and a K. And if she just happens to get that wrong, Tamika ain't voting.
Nope.
And apparently, there have been 70,000 oopsies, 50,000 oopsies, and 70% of those...
70,000, yep.
No, 50,000 oopsies, and 70% of the oopsies have been black.
I've got a question. When the hell did you have to pass a spelling bee to vote? You know? It's ridiculous, you know?
Yeah, it's crazy, Rick.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Rick, thank God that we live in California. You know, I mean, like, you know, everybody knows because, you know, I can't pass a background check because I have a felony. But at least in California, I can still vote.
Yeah.
Because you're still a citizen.
I got my mail-in ballot this week.
I mailed mine in today.
Oh, I have been screwing up something fierce. I am terribly sorry. I've been trying to... Let me bring on the stress line, because when you mentioned you got your mail-in ballot, I know Scott did too, because he posted a picture of it. Hey, Scott. Scott. Oh, wait a minute. Okay, I know what our problem is. Just a minute. For some reason or another, during the great rebooting of the studio today, I got an email from Scott saying he could hear me but couldn't hear anybody else, and I was frantically looking around here going, what the fuck's wrong, oh my God. Well, what the fuck was wrong was that the phone had disconnected itself from the Bluetooth gizmo.
Oops.
Oh, hello. And there's Scott.
There we go.
I apologize profoundly.
No, that's right.
Before you go, let me just update people real quick. Thank you very kindly to James in Illinois. We're down to 140, and there's a $15 challenge on the table, courtesy of Steve, who is not in New York but is in Canada. So that would take us down to 110 to go to finish the week. So thank you, Steve, and thank you, James. We're getting very, very close. Sorry about that. Didn't mean to run over you there. And I'm sorry to have made you wait for so long. But you sent me that email, and it threw. Because like I said at the beginning of the program, nothing screws with me more than technical issues while I'm trying to produce the program.
Yeah, I know, because you've only got two hands, you know.
Yeah, and you don't want to know what happens when I start trying to work with my feet.
No, that's a that deal with Kemp down in Georgia. Those people down there who just find it very inconvenient to have black folks voting. It's like, if you've ever been in a dysfunctional relationship where your significant other at the moment of a problem brings up a litany of things but specializes on maybe one or two, it's like those old-fashioned jukeboxes. Those people their fallback thing is to hit B-17 on the jukebox, okay? And B-17 in this case is the outside agitators phrase that pays, okay? They've been using that shit since the 50s. Or at least
well, precisely. Ron and Raleigh just wrote in a few minutes ago, Scott, and said, what is it, 1962? Outside agitators? Are they commies? Yeah. This reminds me of my youth.
Yeah, but the other thing that you didn't catch was his phraseology regarding, you know, it's, you know, a record number of people have been registered. Registration, going back to Montgomery, you know, every Tuesday the black our Negro friends could come up the courthouse stairs and fill out the form and register. Well, my goodness, registering is not the issue. It's them handling the paperwork truthfully and getting that right, and then you not getting challenged on the day you go to vote.
Right, and that's what I was going to bring up, Scott, is it ain't just Brian Kemp, because they took that exact match bullshit to court before, as I'm sure Steve from Georgistan knows. They took that thing to court, and lo and behold, it got thrown out. And then the Republican legislature of Georgia said, well, let's rewrite it so it won't piss off the judge. And they did. And then Brian Kemp said, instead of saying, you know, we were told this was unconstitutional, I don't think this is right, he said, oh, looky, I get to do it some more. Wipe out 50,000 registrations, Marvelline.
Yeah, and these are not instant, inconsequential numbers. And have we lost all of our national or institutional memory? It was only in the run-up and the playing out of the 2000 election in Florida, where this company was contracted with to go through the names, and let's say the name was John R. Smith Jr. Well, no, Smith is too common. John R. Wilson Jr. Well, let's say John Wilson, no Jr. and no middle initial, was a convicted felon in Florida. Well, it was close enough for government work. Knock him right off the rolls. You don't get to vote. You know, so it's just maddening for someone who has a few viable brain cells to bang together, who also lives in a state where voting and voters are cherished. But in this day and age, the 21st fucking century, they still not only try to get away with, but they manage in many cases to get away with this bullshit. You know, it's just, it boggles my poor overworked mind. But yes, you're right. I got
and it's Georgia, but it's also, and this is a really disgusting example of it. Okay, to back up to what you were talking about with your example, Scott. Let's say the guy in the example in Georgia, Steve from Georgistan, correct me if I'm wrong. Let's say John R. Wilson, who is John R. period Wilson, goes to register to vote, and it says John R. period Wilson on his identifying document. Or okay, let's say it says John Ronald Wilson. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he registers as John R. Wilson, he ain't voting because it's not an exact match.
Yeah. Yeah.
And if Marvelline writes John R. and John R. doesn't, it ain't John R.'s fault, but Marvelline has just single-handedly disenfranchised Mr. Wilson. And that's, in some ways, that's as or more insidious than the Florida example. Then there's North Dakota. Now, Heidi Heitkamp, Heidi Heitkamp, with whom, you know, I've had plenty of issues. You know, she's a diehard devotee of the NRA, for instance. But she's fighting for her political life. And like Joe Manchin, we need her to keep her seat if we're to have a fighting chance take the Senate, even by a one-vote majority. Well, the Supreme Court refused to hear a challenge to an Eighth Circuit Court of Appeal ruling that overturned an injunction issued by the district court because North Dakota passed a rule that said you can't register to vote if you don't have a street address that says you live at 172 Primrose Lane, Fargo, North Dakota, zip code 00000, you know, in that format. And you got to have a real street number, by God. Well, they don't have real street numbers on the reservation. So the United States Supreme Court, so the United States Supreme Court, in refusing to hear that appeal, just disenfranchised a few tens of thousands of Native Americans, most of whom made the difference for Heidi Heitkamp when she won her last election by 3,000 votes.
And when it comes right down to brass tacks, just how disgusting is it that a Native American cannot vote? Let that sink into your mind for a minute. Out of all the shit that we've given them all through their history, here we are, and you can't vote because you don't have a street address, buddy. You got a post office box. We're sorry for you.
Well, the repression doesn't end, John. You know.
No, it doesn't. No, it doesn't.
Native Americans, it's a fucking disgrace, and
I am so sorry.
Not acknowledged in history books. You know, we still celebrate fucking Columbus Day after all. You know.
Yeah.
Well, I don't.
Before I go.
Yeah, it's that old thing of who writes the history, and what is that they're doing down here in Texas? They're trying to get Hillary out of the history books, and
they're doing all kinds of shit. Well, yeah.
It's ridiculous because Texas buys the most books, you know, so we get to decide what the hell's in the goddamn.
They're trying to get rid of Helen Keller too for some reason.
Hey, Scott, go ahead and finish up, and then we'll.
Okay, going back to the business of fucking around with people's ability to vote, okay, let's go to motive for a moment, because you have motive, means, and opportunity. Okay, we're pretty sure of the means. We're pretty sure of the opportunity. So let's go to motive. I say that in many of these situations in these states, the motive is, as the noted political philosopher Red Fox said, when they can see the handwriting on the wall, they're in the toilet. A lot of these people see the handwriting on the wall, that people want a course correction, they want change, they want responsible people in positions of authority and power in their government, because they are the servants of the people, we are the people. And if they are deliberately going through things to make us jump through flaming hoops to exercise our constitutional right, that's bullshit. But the motive is they're doing it, A, because they can until they can't, and they don't want their position of power and authority threatened.
Because it's the only way to win.
Like you said with Kemp. He can't, and all Republicans cannot fight fair. But anyway, that's my opinion.
Well, they can't win if they have to play on a level playing field. Thanks, Scott. You have
okay,
a good
man.
Later.
You too.
Hey, John, welcome aboard. I'm sorry we're having a shorter, another shortened program this evening, but I have to shut down here in a minute. And
I know, Bob, I'm sorry. I had to go to the pharmacy up in town to pick up medicine, and of course it wasn't ready, so they said, please, Mr. Bravo, have a seat. And I was just watching that clock go by. I know.
But hey,
ride into town and back. So
you got Beto out raising the living bejesus out of Rafaelito Eduardo Cruz, the anointed booger-eating future king of America. But
I can't say it like you do, Bob. I just can't. I keep trying, but I just can't.
I got at least 6 years of practice, John, so, you know.
I said it several times, as Bob Kincaid would say it, and then I try to say it.
Oh, you did okay today, John.
Yeah. Thank you, Sparky, for always being there on the Discord there. I was always glad to hear him there. Sparky actually gives me that wind down few minutes right after I turn that camera off, which at times is very well needed. But yeah, no, Bob, I wanted to be on. I was itching for a talk and all that shit, and just life getting
well.
Away.
No, that's okay. I mean, we'll take a couple of minutes, John. Can you offer, because you know, I watch the for-profit media and all the people who love numbers and all that shit, and they're Well, you know, it looks like it's going to turn out like we expected it to be. Cruz will be reelected. He's up 6 points.
A lot of money in there. Bull fucking shit. I don't believe it. I believe Beto is going to have he's up there. The momentum.
Don't do that to me with a mouthful of diet root beer. It hurts like fuck when it comes out my nose, John.
I can't get two words out of my mouth. I got a river in my backyard that's creeping up like you wouldn't believe. And I know they keep telling me it's not going to flood, but I think they're freaking lying to me.
Been right sloppy down your way?
It's pretty. They got some gates at the dam open. They're trying to keep it at 21 feet at my location, because anything down river for me will start getting flooded. And they're trying to dump a bunch of water out of that dam because there's a whole lot of water coming down that river going into that lake pretty soon, within a week. So,
but you're not daunted by all that poll numbers bullshit.
No, sir, I'm not. I, as a matter of fact, I'm going to see Beto O'Rourke Saturday, tomorrow. Today's the 12th, right? The 13th, I'm going to see him, and Joe Kennedy are going to be at Delmar Auditorium, College here at Corpus Christi. I'm going to fight tooth and nail to try to get up in there. You know me, I'm going to want to get a few minutes of camera time with him. But I'm on fire for the guy every time. I'll tell you what's killing me is these ads, Beto O'Rourke, Raphael is running. I mean, they're every few minutes. Every other ad you see on TV is an anti-Beto ad. And he's getting a lot of PAC money from, outside the state. And Beto is determined to do it on his own, baby. But I am still on fire for him. I think the polls are going to end up being wrong. I think there's going to be a hell of a lot more turnout in Texas than they expect. He's on fire all over the country. And I don't know who they're calling on these polls, baby, but they ain't calling me. So I don't know who they're.
Well, if you look at the so-called fundraising disparity, John, Beto's outraised him considerable. But you're saying the white money, we don't call it dark money anymore. That was Alexander's idea, and I think he was
Coke
right.
Brother's money.
Yeah, that white money's sneaking in there and making up the difference. Is Beto running him ad for ad, or, I mean, how's
Beto,
that?
The one I'm seeing right now is Beto. He's in the house, I guess, or somewhere, and it's just him talking into the camera, and it's discuss. He says, we could be defined as what we are fearful of, or we could be defined as what we want for our future, and whether you're Republican or Democrat, that future is what drives us all, and he wants to run. He's running a clean campaign, Bob. He's not running dirt like Ted does, or every other politician in this country. That's one of the reasons I'm so proud of the guy. It's because he doesn't go down there. He doesn't attack anybody. He's standing up for what he believes in and what he thinks the future should look like. And when you listen to him, baby, it's clear cut. You know, what is that, 540 some odd people in this country that decide every freaking thing we ever do? That's who does
this. And it just straight up pissed me off. I mean, being up here in West Virginia, you know what I'm dealing with in my Senate race.
Yes, sir.
It's not exactly exciting. But I've seen I've seen some hand wringing and some pearl clutching from people saying, people, Beto's just sucking up all the small donation money. People need to be sending money to Claire McCaskill and Heidi Heitkamp and poor, poor Joe Manchin. Pardon me if I steal a line from you. Are you shitting me?
Yeah, really.
Somebody who's inspired by Beto O'Rourke's message of hope is going to go, I'm going to send my $5 to the coal whore in West Virginia.
Yeah, that guy, he's my man. I'll send it to him. You know, Beto has raised a whole lot of money, and $38 million, I think it was, here recently, the number I saw. But that's from small donations here in Texas, and that's enough to make you proud. But the fact is that he's playing on an unlevel field with shit that Ted Cruz does. And there is no message. I have not seen a single positive message that Ted Cruz puts out. It's all evil shit, the evil Democrats, the evil socialists, MS-13's coming to rape your daughter. It's all that. You know, and again, what we were talking about the other day, that's the only thing they have. They don't have a vision. They have fear, and they want to stoke that fear.
Beto's packing them in on his college
of
tour.
Everybody. Yes, he is, baby. Everywhere he goes. That's what I mean. I don't believe these numbers. You look at where every
and
man,
that's why, and that, and, that and again, goes. There's another one of those stories. That's why they're busting their ass to try to keep students from voting at Prairie View A&M, a historically black college in Texas, and they're doing everything in their power to keep students away from the polls. You know, I don't think you get to say that you believe in democracy if you don't believe
that's
that everybody
right,
who has the right to vote should vote.
That's right. That is right. And you look at who they target. They're not targeting the white, you know, middle-aged guy or the white. They're targeting minorities. That's who they target because they know traditionally minorities will go on the Democratic because we're more social, you know, society. We're more concerned with social issues than we are worrying about, well, that's who we're going to go attack
right. And,
next.
And we actually have the real big tent. And so I'm hoping there's big doings this weekend. I think we can officially, in addition to everything else I refer to him as, I think we can refer to him as Rafaelito Chicken Shit Cruz, having bailed out on two, you know. He was offered free airtime, and no. So CNN's announced,
Bob,
Beto gets the whole hour.
News station.
Ted Cruz has backed out of that. I didn't know that. They were at CNN was advertising a big debate this Thursday.
Yep.
That's awesome.
Beto,
huh?
It's going to be a one-man show, Beto O'Rourke.
Good.
Because Ted Cruz was too chicken shit. Yes,
what
ma'am. Tracy,
shit.
How are you, darling?
I'm great. I saw this article as soon as I saw it, and I'm like, I would have sent it to you, but I don't have your email or whatever. But I put it in the chat. It was about how Beto might have a new base of support with white evangelical women.
With Republicans, Tracy?
Yes.
There's people down here in Texas that are putting signs out, this Republican is voting Democrat this year to save our country. And that is a powerful statement, and I wish more Republicans, more conservatives, so-called, you know, conservatives, would wake it up to that, and realize just what it means to be
an American.
A patriot. That's right, an American. That's right, baby, and
because
we all stand up.
I was listening to something about
we
nationalism.
Fight for each other.
Hey, I hate to.
Does that mean patriotism?
I hate to interrupt, but I've got to bail out. That doesn't mean y'all can't keep the conversation going, but I've just got to disconnect because I got to get ready to do what I got to do at 9. And
Bob, I promise I'll be here next time.
Well, oh, by the way, I told Sparky next Friday is Sparky's birthday, and it's the night before Bridge Day, so I'm taking the night off, and Sparky's taking. I don't know if Sparky's going to take the night off or not, but it's Bridge Day, so.
Jump.
I'm here.
I'm gonna be hanging out around the smoker, working on that brisket and trying to, brisket's a Texas thing. I will try to do you proud with that, John.
I'm sure you will, Bob. I've seen your food porn, buddy. You're doing a fine job.
Well, I thank you, sir. So probably unless something changes dramatically, there won't be a Friday on the front porch next week. But I wanted to thank you all very kindly. And announce that we have on our hands here an official community-made Friday on the Front Porch miracle. Dwayne, down in Georgia, just put us over the top and finished it for the whole week.
Way to go, Dwayne.
All right, Dwayne.
Outstanding.
And thank you, Billable Rick, as well. Thanks for the challenge, Steve. Thanks for getting it all started to Charlene and to Darlene. And that's Rhode Island and Connecticut. I don't know if we've ever had contiguous challenges before. But thank you to Charlene and Darlene, and thank you to Mike and Cascadia. Y'all got the ball rolling, and it could not have happened without you. Thanks to everybody who took this monumental weight off of my tiny little brains. There's going to be some bills paid with the real with real panache about 5 hours from now. So thanks, everybody. Thank you to the Extraordinary Ordinary Roundtable panel of Friday on the Front Porch. Thank you to all of you who share your precious finite time engaging in this ongoing conversation. Thank you to our all-volunteer staff. Thank you to Sparky and in the chat room and in the Skype group. Thank you to Steve from Georgistan in the chat room. Thank you to our news ninjas. Thank you, Brother Deacon Asa, headon.live. Thank you very kindly to John Fox in Australia. Thank you, Ben Birch, whiterosesociety.org. Thank you to the hardest working, bravest people I know, the men and women of Coal River Mountain Watch. Steve in New York says, please give Tracy my best. Done. Thank you, Steve. And always, 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 Gina, it's all for you. Join me in a little less than an hour as I sub on this Friday evening for the incomparable Mike Malloy over on Progressive Voices on TuneIn Radio. I'll be looking forward to it. Have a great weekend, everybody. Later.